again and welcome to another Tuesday Bulletin of Engineering Information from the IBA. As BSB prepares for its official opening this Sunday, we talk to their company's marketing controller for direct-to-home equipment and take a look around the impressive Marco Polo building. In transmitter news, the usual roundup of special announcements, and we've full details of two new television relays, Haverford West in southwest Wales and Roos in Cumbria.
It was as long ago as August that the BSB satellite, Marco Polo 1, was successfully launched into space by a Delta rocket from Cape Canaveral. BSB is using the new transmission technology of DMAC. Much of the development work on MAC has been done by the IBA. Delays to the start of the service have been mainly due to reception equipment, which is of an entirely new breed, requiring specially designed integrated circuits. Meanwhile, in February, the IBA's uplink station at Chilworth became fully operational on all five channels allocated for UK satellite broadcasting, again pioneering new technology. Finally, on the 25th of March, programmes began for the benefit of cable viewers and public demonstrations. Direct-to-home viewing begins this Sunday with the official opening of all five channels and the start of a new chapter in British broadcasting history. BSB operates from impressive headquarters just south of Chelsea Bridge in London. The entrance hall is like a vast high-tech glass cathedral, and it was there that Bruce Randall talked to John Slater about the new domestic receivers and the way the services are being introduced.
John, a phased launch, one channel per night on cable, then a month later, the direct-to-home launch. Yeah. Why did you decide to do it that way?
Well, we wanted to try and overcome the difficulties that have been associated with the Sky launch last year. And there's always this difficulty that you need to have programmes there to demonstrate the product and to sell the product. And, of course, then manufacturers need to have confidence that the retailers are going to order large quantities of material, and they're only going to do that when they're confident the broadcast is there. And you have this sort of chicken and egg situation that we wanted to break into. We thought the best way to do that was to stagger the launch over a period of a month. And that would give time for equipment to come in for display purposes, time for equipment to come in to start to satisfy our launch club members, and that would make the whole thing more manageable logistically for the industry.
And when we talked last time, BSB receivers seemed an awful long way off. Now yeah. We have them here in front of us, one of each of the four manufacturers. They all look fairly similar. Are they going to be out in quantity? Will choose the one they want, will they get them by the direct-to-home launch time?
Well, around now, in fact, the first piece of equipment are already turning up onto the shop floor. And that equipment is firstly going into live demonstration facilities for in-store use. And towards the end of April, we should be cutting into the first of the launch club registered members, and they'll be getting their equipment. So, yes, equipment will be there for demonstration purposes, across all outlets, we hope, by the end of this month, and we'll be supplying our first consumers. Then by the end of June, which is the last time for Launch Club members to come back in store and complete their transactions, we expect to have delivered something like three times the total number of bits of equipment required to satisfy all Launch Club members. So that's about 120,000 pieces of equipment by the end of June.
So if you're not a Launch Club member, you may just have to wait a few weeks to actually get hold of a receiver.
There's no doubt that in the first couple of months equipment's going to be tight, but you'll just have a wait, I guess, of around 4 weeks at most if you're a fresh member of the public who's coming in for the first time and wanting to buy equipment.
The receivers are slightly different on the outside, but presumably they're fairly similar on the inside in terms of design and facilities. How do they compare to, say, a Sky receiver?
Well, they're all DMAC receivers. They're very different from Sky equipment in that sense. They have some common features, which are some rather nice consumer features. For example, all of them have on-screen display facilities that mean that when you change channel, you actually see on screen the name of the station that you're watching, and that appears momentarily. They also have a neat feature when you set up the unit and first install the unit. You have a facility there for seeing the signal strength, and that gives you an opportunity later on, should there be a problem developing with the antenna on the roof, or indeed with the receiver, for you to actually establish which element is at fault. Is it the antenna, the installation, is it the receiver? because you have that signal strength meter. You have some other facilities. You have a button here you can press, and that allows you to see what the next program is going to be coming up shortly, and it tells you how much time there is left on the program that you're currently watching. There is also a facility by pressing into the menu to get into the parental control facility. Now that's quite a unique feature. It allows you, by entering your own unique PIN number, to access a facility for selecting out certain types of programs that either you or your family you would like to not be able to watch. So for example, you can select out programs that have explicit sex or violence or bad language. You can actually select in terms of the film channel whether you want to watch X-rated films or not, or U-only films and so on. Well, that's quite a unique feature. So there are a number of facilities that are available on each and every one of these receivers that you won't find on a Sky receiver.
Why did BSB get involved with receiving equipment? Why didn't you just stick to being a broadcaster?
Well, of course, we had to do something in terms of facilitating the technical development. Somebody needed to take a leading role, both in terms of finding the finance and actually making a decision on some certain technical standards. So there we had to get involved. We also had a job to do in terms of ensuring quality standards were adhered to, both in terms of the antennas and also in terms of the receivers themselves.
And you've taken a lot of stick over the last few months about delays, timescales and squareals. What do you say to the critics who say you've got it all wrong?
Well, BSB is now live, BSB is broadcasting, the equipment is there, and it's excellent equipment. It's an excellent product. It's an excellent product in terms of physical equipment here and also in terms of the programming. It was worth waiting for, and it was worth getting it right and doing it right first time. That's what we have done. We're now in the business to take advantage of a major opportunity for all of us and for the future with DMAC technology.
Away from the spacious entrance hall and landings, the technical areas of the Marco Polo building are more compact than you might expect, with a high degree of automation. But there are still many tasks which depend on the skill of a trained operator, such as transferring film to videotape for transmission, and indeed the panning and scanning of films. This is where cinema films are carefully previewed, shot by shot, and the chosen scanned area logged into a computer, so that the normal 4:3 picture ratio of ordinary sets always displays the important action areas of the widescreen presentation. There are also two fairly modest production studios, although much of the material comes in from outside sources. But the master control room is undeniably impressive, with 5 simultaneous outputs to be monitored and controlled, as well as the various pictures coming into the building. So it's all up and running, and while receiving systems are not going to be plentiful in the early weeks, production does look set to meet demand by about June. Of course, the proof of the pudding is in the eating, and whatever we say about technology, it's the programs that really count, the programs by which BSB will ultimately stand or fall.
Special announcements now, and in Lancashire, work was due to begin today, weather permitting, on replacing the Winter Hill transmitting aerial. There'll be some early morning short breaks and then generally 6 dB reduced power until further notice. The work will last for several months, but should ultimately improve reception in some traditionally difficult areas. BBC channels are not affected, as there's a separate aerial for those services.
Other news, and Tenby and Dovard will be off on all channels today from 9:30 to 10:30 a.m. for an electrical inspection.
In the Midlands, Kidderminster is due to be off from 6 till 9:30 this morning while the BBC do their aerial maintenance.
Tomorrow morning from 9:30 to 11:30, HTV and S4C will be off from Munnoth Muckan for IBA electrical maintenance.
And at Patcham in West Sussex, all channels will be off tomorrow from 6 a.m. till midday for aerial maintenance.
Near Port Talbot in South Wales, Munnoth Emroch will be off tomorrow afternoon from 3:30 till 6 o'clock for electricity board work.
On Thursday, all channels from Ramsbottom will be off from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. due to maintenance by the electricity board. Finally, in East Sussex, Rye will be off the air from 6 a.m. till midday on Thursday, while the aerial feeders are replaced.
Community radio next, and in Birmingham, Buzz FM, currently on test on 102.4 megahertz with vertical polarisation from Metropolitan House, is due in service on the 14th of May. Buzz aims to provide a sophisticated music-based service for a unified audience of multi-ethnic adults by day, with specialist interest programmes each evening for a potential audience of just under 1 million.
Television relays now, and in Dyfed, a new station about 9 miles north of Haverford West is due on the air in early May. This is for about 320 people in Puncheston, Castlebyth, Little Newcastle and Rosebush. It will also help another 40 viewers at present marginally served by Preseli. Programmes from HTV Wales and TVAM will be on Channel 56, with S4C on 68. Group CD aerials are required with horizontal polarisation. Haverford West is due on the air in early May.
And up in Cumbria, a new relay is being built at Roos, a mile to the east of Barrow-in-Furness, to improve UHF coverage for an estimated population of 580 in the Roos area. A further 300 people presently marginally served by Winter Hill, Millam Park or Dalton could also benefit from the new station. Because of severe channel constraints, it has been necessary to employ both vertical and horizontal polarisation in different directions from this site. Granada and TVAM will be on Channel 29 and Channel 4 on 39. The aerial group is W, with vertical polarisation to the west of the site and horizontal in other directions. Roos is also due on the air in early May.
And that's all for this week, but do get in touch if you have any technical queries on independent broadcasting. Our address, Engineering Information, Independent Broadcasting Authority, Crawley Court, Winchester, Hampshire, SO21 2QA. Our telephone number is Winchester, that's 0962 822 444. Office hours are 8:30 to 4:30. At other times, there's an answering machine. Don't forget our link line number at a local rate from anywhere in the country, 0345 07 8787. We hope you'll join us again next Tuesday when we'll be looking at widescreen television and higher definition in the third and final part of our series on the Mac system. But for now, from Janet Solkeld and from me, Adrian Good, goodbye from Crawley Court.